I want to thank everyone on the NHS frontline, as well as care workers and those carrying out essential roles, who selflessly continue their day-to-day duties outside the home in support of us all.
Queen Elizabeth there thanking the people the UK is depending on right now. 10 Downing Street echoed that sentiment in the statement announcing Boris Johnson's hospitalisation, saying this: the Prime Minister thanks NHS staff for all of their incredible hard work and urges the public to continue to follow the government's advice to stay at home, protect the NHS and save lives. Well, joining me now, one of those people on the front lines, Dr. Simon Walsh, consults in emergency medicine. He is the deputy chair of the British Medical Association Consultant Committee. And we do want to honour, it is an honour for us to speak with you and salute your brave work on the front lines. How are you coping right now with the number of patients and what's been the hardest part of this?
Good morning, Rosemary. Thanks very much for your kind words there, and it was really welcome to hear the words of our monarch last night, Queen Elizabeth, at a time when the NHS is under the greatest challenge that it's ever faced. I'm an emergency medicine consultant working in an emergency department, one of the big emergency departments in London, and along with my colleagues across the country, we are clearly finding this is a very difficult time and a big challenge. The number of cases is rising, and we're doing our best to manage that.
Yeah, understandably. And of course, most doctors and nurses across the globe have struggled to get enough supplies of personal protective equipment and ventilators as they fight to save lives. What's been your experience with those supplies?
Yeah, well, so the British Medical Association has highlighted some real concerns about the personal protective equipment supply to frontline healthcare workers. And it's clear that there have been some problems with that. Along with the testing for healthcare workers and their families so they can get back to work if they're negative. With the personal protective equipment, clearly it's absolutely imperative that healthcare workers are given the equipment so they can work safely. We all want to be there on the front line doing everything we can to help patients. But we can't be expected to do that whilst risking our own health and our lives, indeed, if we're not given the right equipment. And I'm afraid that despite the assurances that we've been given that over the last few weeks that the supply and the personal protective equipment has been procured, we're still hearing stories where frontline doctors and nurses are not able to access that when they need it.
Yeah, and that, sadly, is the story everywhere. It's certainly here in the United States. We heard it across Italy and Spain and elsewhere, and it is mind-boggling that enough of those supplies can't get to the doctors because you have to use so much when you're looking after this amount of patients. So what happens if you don't have enough ventilators? What decisions are you and other doctors having to make on who lives and who dies?
Well, the question of ventilators is another very important one. We know that we haven't yet reached the peak in London, let alone the rest of the UK. And London is probably a couple of weeks ahead of the rest of the UK in terms of the rising number of cases. And yet we're still, we're not even at the peak, but we have a huge demand for ventilators. And clearly a lot of, one of the features of this disease is that there are a large proportion of people do require respiratory support ventilation with a mechanical ventilator. Now there have been some extraordinary efforts done to increase the numbers of ventilators available. I'm afraid we didn't start from a very good point, having very few intensive care beds and ventilators per head of population compared with the rest of Europe. But we consultants and doctors throughout the NHS trusts across the UK have, through massive effort, managed to at least double their intensive care capacity, and in many hospitals go several times over what their normal ability is to ventilate patients. Having said that, it's predicted that we will need somewhere in the region of 18,000 ventilators at the peak, and as I understand it, at the moment we only have about 9,000 available, so we still have a long way to go, I'm afraid.
It has been a horrifying wake-up call for so many countries, hasn't it? And I think what has surprised so many people is the United Kingdom and the United States haven't been in a particularly good position with this, and a lot of their systems have been laid bare. But that is another story for another time. Dr. Simon Walsh, I want to take another opportunity to thank you for all that you do and all the medical professionals across the globe, because it is extraordinary what you're doing, and under these sort of circumstances, when you don't have enough protection gear, even more so. Thank you so very much.
Thank you very much.